When is a milkshake not a milkshake? Food and sex have always been linked, as both are essential parts of life, base level needs. And what combines seems like a good idea in the moment. In reality, it often ends in unpleasant stickiness, itching, and potential infection. Pop music has always had an attraction for suggestive culinary lyrics. And while sometimes used to avoid censorship, there's something to be gained from a little subtlety in art. Not every artist can be a poet of Trent Reznor proportions. But what is the history of the practice? What are the best examples? And most importantly, what is Milkshake by Khalees actually about? Some of the earliest examples of sexy food songs in recorded music were present in early jazz and blues records. A frequently used foodstuff with provocative connotations in jazz circles was the jelly roll. The term is black slang from the 19th century, depending on context, either a noun referring to the genitals of either sex or a verb for the act itself. Famous early player Third Jelly Roll Morton took the slang as his moniker. Such was his apparent sexual aura. He even wrote an almost eponymous track in Original Jelly Roll Blues, an instrumental but one of the first jazz songs ever to be published, the first version in 1915. Later artists like Mammy Smith and Bessie Smith released tracks using the term. Now I ain't gonna give nobody none of this jelly roll. I mean my jelly roll. No other town can make a sweet jelly roll so fine. Which, to the unknowing, sounds all too much like these women were showing off their baked goods. Which is way more twee than what is actually being implied. Cake-based innuendo didn't stop in the 1950s. More recent examples of the same are present in the curiously short Birthday Cake by Rihanna, which is most likely about some kind of oral pleasure. It's only my birthday, but you wanna lick the icing on. But then, throw subtlety out the window with the outro. Up until that point, it could have totally been about the pleasures of eating cake. Then there's DNCE's Cake by the Ocean, where that sweet, sweet craving is named after their Swedish producer's mistranslation of Sex on the Beach. Again, it's about fucking. Plus, there's Warrant's Cherry Pie, which gives away what it's actually about in this one shot from its music video. Back to the 1930s, blues musicians seem more interested in fruit as genital analogies. Like, for example, Bo Carter with his song Banana in Your Fruit Basket. Let me put my banana in your fruit basket, then I'll be satisfied. Go, let my banana score now. Either it's an ode to the many do's and don'ts of banana storage, or something a bit more suspect. Perhaps the most famous blues-era fruit allusion comes from the Traveling Riverside Blues by famous devil deal maker Robert Johnson. You can feed my lemon tail, just run down my bed. That's what I'm talking about now. Led Zeppelin liked the song so much they covered it and then stole some of the lyrics for their Lemon song. To quote the AV Club, they brought the line to mass popularity in the Lemon song, and either grossed out or intrigued a nation of young ladies. This continued throughout the invention of rock and roll. Little Richard's Tutti Frutti, arguably the first rock and roll song, on face value is gibberish. But those lyrics can't hide the sexuality of Richard's performance. It's clearly about something way dirtier than simply ice cream. According to his drummer from the mid-50s, the unrecordable lyrics he used to sing in the nightclubs were
Tutti Frutti, good booty. If it's tight, it's all right. If it's greasy, it makes it so easy.
While fruits are a recurring theme within the subgenre, sugar, candy, and other processed sweet things are also used just as frequently. It makes sense that such pleasurable acts are seen as sweet. For example, I Want Candy, originally by the Stranglers, later covered by Bow Wow Wow. While not exactly about any specific sexual act, the song emphasizes the lip-smacking sweetness of their respective candies. Along the same lines is the Jamaican pop bop My Boy Lollipop by Millie Small, which uses the sweet treat as a veiled metaphor for a penis and the act of fellatio. You are a sweet ass candy. You're my sugar dandy. If you dive in, it becomes all the more disturbing as the carefree ska singer claims that her beau is nothing more than his member, dehumanizing him and renaming him after the popular hard candy. He is literally a boy lollipop, and most importantly, hers. You are my one desire. Confectionery was also used in Lil Wayne's song Lollipop, which made the comparison all the more blatant. By the end of the 1960s, there was even a genre named after the sweet stuff, bubblegum, a genre that excelled at making ultra-sweet yet factory-produced pop music. One of the biggest songs in this short-lived genre was Ohio Express's Yummy Yummy Yummy. Yummy yummy yummy, I got love in my tummy and chilly as it may seem. Which asserts that it is just about consuming love, and not at all about anything else. But those orgasmic moans hidden in the post-chorus are telling a different story, and aren't simply from food enjoyment. Another famous bubblegum song, Sugar Sugar by the Archies, is still one of the biggest selling songs of all time. And while it is about love in the most naive sense, with its mentions of sugar and honey, listeners have inferred it to be about other gooey sticky stuff, especially that lyric near the end. The performers of the track have denied its potentially sexual undercurrents, but that didn't stop it from inspiring one of the most frequently used stripper songs of all time. Though dominated by Prince's risque body of work, probably the most iconic food sex song of the 80s was Def Leppard's Pour Some Sugar On Me. As previously mentioned, the title was somewhat inspired by Sugar Sugar, the first single singer Joe Elliott ever bought, which he believes had a subliminal effect on him. But what was the proclamation supposed to mean? While the idiom, give me some sugar, is to give someone a kiss, to pour some sugar suggests that it's something way more impassioned. The cocksure rhythm justifies the song is most definitely naughty in nature. But is this song as dirty as it sounds? Elliot has stated that it is a metaphor for whichever sexual preference you care to enjoy, which is hugely underwhelming. The lyrics were composed out of whatever worked phonetically, using the emergent rap rock genre staple, Walk This Way, as a calling point. The first lyric locked in was the opening, which gave the song a logical starting point from which to extrapolate. This doesn't mean that fans haven't made up more specific theories about its intended meaning, like a reported four-way guitarist Phil Collins experienced, or various ejaculate permutations. When asked in 2015 on Albany radio station Q103 whether he actually poured sugar on anyone, Elliot replied,
I think we once had a competition backstage to actually pour like a pound of sugar over some poor girl's head who'd been, you know, saturated in hot water so that the stuff stuck all over.
Oh no.
You know, It was written in the contract that it had to be done, no doubt. So, yeah, I think maybe about 25 years ago, we did it the one time.
The fruit that is probably most used as double entendre is the peach. This has ranged from the innocence of 50s crooners claiming that the girl is a peach, or using the now dated expression, peachy keen, to mean very satisfactory or fine. But more modern recalibration for the fruit is likening it to many different elements of female sexuality. A lusty peach emoji means something beyond produce, and pop music is all for it. Going backwards slightly, we have the Stranglers' punk classic, Peaches. The song seemingly a selection of horny come-ons, as the singer peruses the seafront, birdwatching, paired with a thrusting low-ended bass line. Walking on the beaches, looking at the peaches. The second verse also has a word that seems to want to sound like clitoris. Is she trying to get out of that clitoris? Liberation for women, that's what I preach. But it's supposed to be clitoris, which the band have alleged is a French bathing suit. But a quick Google search reveals that the word doesn't exist anywhere aside from in this song. But if he is saying clitoris, the line doesn't make sense anyway. The song was written as a response to one of the first waves of political correctness in the late 1970s, its blatantness a kick against the implied censorship they saw around them. The Joker by the Steve Miller Band also compares attraction to a woman to a peach. I really love your peaches, wanna shake your tree. Where peaches could refer to breasts and shaking her tree to make love, Peaches by the Presidents of the United States of America is a different basket of fruit altogether. Wanting to hide their intentions and get a better chance of being played on MTV, the band at first conceal what the song is actually about, double bluffing with the early lyrics. Peaches come from a can, they were put there by a man. Clearly, there is no innuendo here. But in verse 2, the curtain is pulled. Squished a rotten peach in my fist and dreamed about you, a woman. This is not a song about summer fruit, but something equally juicy and traditionally fuzzy. Then there's Partition by Beyoncé. Overall, a very sexually explicit song about having relations in the back of a limo, which includes such gems as, oh, he's so horny, yeah, he went too far. He popped on my buttons and he ripped my blouse. He Monica Lewinsky'd all on my gown. In the second verse, Beyoncé sings, he likes to call me peaches when we get this nasty. Either this is a reference to Beyoncé claiming that in moments of passion, she is personified simply by a famed asset, or, according to one shaky source, is a reference to a dirty-minded electro-feminist, Peaches, famed for songs like Fuck the Pain Away. So Peaches, a universal symbol for female sexuality that can be used in any situation. The most iconic modern sensual food jam is without a doubt Milkshake by Khalees. Few songs, not just in this subgenre, have the instant recognition of its opening line. My milkshake brings all the boys to the yard and they're like, it's better than yours. Paired with that ultra suggestive music video. But what was her milkshake referring to? Khalees's assertion is that whatever this thing is, it makes her irresistible to men. Many have thought it was a covert way of talking about her breasts, fellatio, or maybe the nebulous, intangible sensuality or attractiveness that she possesses. But which is it? The line, I could teach you, but I have to charge, might rule out any of her physical attributes, but fellatio would still be an option. Then milkshake has been slang for breasts since the 1910s. When the song was released back in 2003, Khalees stated, to me, a milkshake itself represents the essence of a woman. It's that thing that men are drawn to about women and what separates one sex from the other. But in 2017, however, Khalees stated that milkshake as a metaphor means lots of things. It likens the special quality that makes a woman attractive to a dessert. But like pretty much every other song I've talked about, is up to you, the listener, for your interpretation. What's so special about Milkshake is that, while other tracks reduce their lust interest to the organ of their desire, Khalise defiantly makes herself the main attraction. She is what drives the men wild, and the song insists that she should be celebrated for that. That feeling of self-worth and self-confidence, and women could latch on to that message. Khalise said in a 2014 interview, "I love the song, I know what it meant. I know what it did for music and for female artists in that era. I'm not saying I single-handedly did it, but you know, it played a huge part in where music went. I'm aware of that." Alongside Beyoncé's Crazy in Love, Milkshake is clearly one of the most influential pop songs of the 2000s. And all because of a sexualized dessert. Not all songs about food are actually about sex. One of the most famous tunes about chowing down, Weird Al Yankovic's Eat It, is completely absent of baby-making allusion. Have a banana, have a whole bunch. It doesn't matter what you had for lunch. Just eat it, eat it, eat it. But food sex songs are still a cultural force, even if they are a lot less subtle than the jazz and blues songs of old. Getting to the point where subtext has become text. Opposite is the Pepsi Cola. My eyes are wide like cherry pies. The more undefined connotations of Milkshake, Pour Some Sugar on Me, or the interchangeable implications of peaches or jelly rolls has made it so people can take whatever they want from these songs. Maybe they are devoted hymns to that life force renewing, essential part of existence. Songs that sing the eternal praises of one of the key components in human survival. Or maybe, just maybe, Milkshake is just about a milkshake. Thanks for watching. What are some of your favorite sexual food lyrics? If you enjoyed this video, maybe like, comment, and subscribe. If you really liked it, why not think about becoming a patron? Patrons get rewards like advanced screenings, exclusive playlists, and just generally being cooler people. Many thanks to my current top tier supporters. You're all awesome. See you in 2 weeks.